Good morning, everybody. Welcome on a nice cold morning. I walked out this morning, it was 6 below. I was like, oh, that hurts to breathe.
When they're done, whoever doesn't.
Boy, that light is blinding. Woo! You guys will stand, open up in a scripture this morning. Comes from Ephesians chapter 1, starting in verse 19. And what is an immeasurable greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his great might, that he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at the right hand of the heavenly places, far above all rule, authority, and power, and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in what is to come.
There's no space that his love can reach. There's no place where we can find peace. There's no end to amazing grace. Take me in with your arms spread wide. Take me in like an orphan child. Never let go, never leave my side. Holding on to you, I am holding on to you. In the middle of the storm, I'm holding on, I am. Love like this, oh my God, to fight. I am overwhelmed with the joy, delight. Love like this sets our hearts on fire.
I am holding on to you. I am holding on to you. In the middle of the storm, I'm holding on. I am. I can see the waters raging at my feet. I can feel the breath of those surrounding me. I can hear the sound of nations rising up. We will not be overtaken. We will not be overcome. I can walk down this dark and painful road. I can face every fear of the unknown. I can hear all God's children singing out. We will not be overtaken. We will not be overcome. The same power that rose Jesus from the grave, same power that commands the dead to wake, lives in us, lives in us. The same power that moves mountains when he speaks, the same power that can calm a raging sea, lives in us, lives in us. He lives in us, lives in us. We have hope that his promises are true. In his strength there is nothing we can do. Yes, we know there are greater things in store. We will not be overtaken. We will not be overcome. The same power that rose Jesus from the grave, the same power that commands the dead to wake, lives in us, lives in us. The same power that moves mountains when he speaks, the same power that can calm a raging sea, lives in us.
Thank you for giving us that power, Lord, that, you know, that power that has moved mountains can live in us. We have the same abilities. Lord, just help us to have a great day, to open our minds and hearts to what Pastor Tom brings to us. Give him the wisdom to relay it to us. Help everyone that can't be here today, whether they're sick or just the weather has them out, whatever it may be, just watch over them. Just thank you for giving us the opportunity to come to your house to worship you and learn about you. In your name I pray. Amen.
Hey, Who has a praise or a testimony to share this morning? We've got a full house. Somebody has to have a praise or a testimony this morning.
I'm just going to say this real quick. I'm going to praise him through the storm. Woohoo!
Anyone else this morning?
So a friend of mine, and Ken would know, and Glenn's here, his dad passed away. And so that's the sad part of the story, but the overwhelming, like I kept up with it with his daughters on Facebook, and seeing a man of faith come to glory and seeing his family worship with him in that time, and just seeing how for us men especially, how we lead our kids and youth, and seeing his children grow into people that love God greatly. And through that whole time, the beauty of that family worshiping God through the hardship and the sorrow of a loss. But for me, just seeing it as an outsider and understanding the pain that family, you know, is losing the patriarch of the family. However, through that, they praised and they worshiped God, and what a beautiful testimony it is for Mike as a father to see his children walk through that and praise God and quote scripture on Facebook and stuff like that. So that's my testimony, just seeing, you know, what a man can do with his family. So you got kids and young kids, and instill into them the values of Christ, and someday you will see the reward of that.
Anyone else this morning?
I thought that was a yeah.
All right. Well, if nobody else wants to share, I'm actually going to bring Hillary up. Surprise. Hillary is from Next Step, and she comes once a year to kind of give us some updates. This is one of the local missions that we support in the area. So,
do we have our video? Oh, we do. Take the liberty to use this nice little stand up here. I'll probably knock all my papers off anyhow. I'm old school. I still bring papers to read from. I don't have a tablet or a phone or anything. I do, but I don't know how to run them very well. I was so grateful that my development coordinator, she put this little video together, because I thought it really kind of was a nice introduction for what Next Step is continuing to do, what we have done, and what we continue to hope to do. In Genesis 1:27, it says, "Let us make man in our image." So this is really the plumb line of what we do at Next Step. We want to communicate what image we're made in. We're made in God's image, and we want to communicate that to the abortion vulnerable women that we're meeting with. That is the key. She has to know who she is before we can help her see the value of the life that she's carrying. We want to be able to invest in her. And the other part of that scripture that stands out is that it is us and our. We know that God is three in one. He is relational. So he wants us to be relational to all of those that come through our door or the ones that we work with outside of the office. And so there's kind of three parts to this. Last year when I shared, we talked a little bit about the abortion-minded woman and kind of what we're seeing in the movement in that. And that has created some challenges for Next Step, particularly because we were founded and will continue to move in the mission of supporting women who find themselves in a unplanned, or as I'm reading it now, a mistimed pregnancy. The language is always changing. So that will be what we always stand on, to support that woman and help her to know that abortion is just not an option. It doesn't have to be an option. That does not have to be her option. But what we're seeing is a transition kind of in our society, in our culture in general. And we're finding that abortion-minded woman is harder and harder to get to. We have a society that, you know, anything goes as far as sex, relationship, cohabitation is at its highest. You know, promiscuity is just, it runs rampant. And so now that we're seeing the trend that abortion pills can be mailed to the woman's home, so now the pregnancy test that she can get at the Dollar Tree is no longer a relevant service for Next Step to offer. I mean, we have some pregnancy test clients still coming in, but now she can also, from the comforts of her own home, take that abortion pill that can be ordered online. So what does a pregnancy center do? How do we combat this? How do we still continue to serve our community well? This morning I was doing a little reading, and God has really kind of impressed on me that in all things we are to rejoice. So even in the storms, that's what I liked about the songs this morning, even in the storms we're to praise him. And the scripture that I want to read is Psalm 66:6. He turned the sea into dry land. They passed through the waters on foot. Come, let us rejoice in him. And it's really a profound statement, through the waters. I love the beach. It's like my happy place. I'm not there often enough, and I think I was born in the wrong state. Now transition to me sitting in the car wash last night. I wasn't in the car wash. I mean, I was in the car. We had the car in the car wash. Car washes terrify me. I won't do it alone. I make my husband take it in because I don't know. I've had mirrors knocked off. It's an ugly business to be in a car wash with me. But it's really terrifying to have that, I don't know, that water slapping up against the car and those, you know, those bars or whatever. It just, I don't know. For me, it's scary. Anyone else scared of, okay, thank you. I'm not the only crazy person. But it's interesting reading that scripture. You know, if you imagine walking on dry land, you still have these waters piled, like, I mean, you have walls of water. Imagine walking through that. And I think walking through storms, sometimes I can tend to lean into God a little bit more. It's when he has us journeying, just, you're just walking around, you know, got the backpack, you got the water bottle, and you're just walking. You're like, okay, God, what are you doing? What are you doing? And that's what it's been for the past 5 years. You guys have heard many, many updates. We have been trying to transition to medical. That is still on the table. We're making a little bit of a shift on that medical piece, though, and I'll get to that in just a moment. But recently, we've had a couple that has been coming in. And why I say God is relational. A lot of the women that come through our door, they are coming through because word of mouth. It has been somebody who has been supporting them. And so the slide that I want to show you here with Sierra and Colby. You know, they both came out of very dysfunctional families. Unfortunately, Colby's family, his parents were, they were just out of the picture. He was a problem. He was a nuisance. So that's kind of what he grew up with. I love that man's testimony about men and fathers stepping into their children's lives and how critical that is. But unfortunately, Colby didn't have that. Now you have Sierra. She is pregnant. She's finishing out her senior year at high school. She is virtual. She's a virtual student. But she, too, comes from a very dysfunctional family. What she heard growing up, once again, she is a problem. Everything she does is a problem. She's a troublemaker. That's all she is. That's all she's ever going to be. So you have these two who have come through our door because someone, a family member, was worried about them. This family member said, come on, let's go to Next Step. Let's see what they can do for you. Let's see how they can support you in this mistimed pregnancy. And so hearing from this couple, it's great to hear their love for each other, but they think their relationship's going to survive on love and ramen noodles. And, as much as you want to get behind them on that, we know that that's just not the case. So we've been working with this couple. Actually, separately, we have a gentleman, Don Jeffer, step in to begin working with this kid and investing in the fatherhood program that we have available. And then I'm working with Sierra. Now, many of you might think, we'll go ahead and go to the next slide, because that is a lot of what we're working on is using our Bright Course curriculum. So we have programs for pregnancy, how to care for a baby, all of those practical things. But I'm not so concerned that she won't be able to feed or diaper a baby as much as I am, what will the legacy be passed down to that baby? What kind of life will this child have? And so through the one program that we have, it's called Parenting Without Shame. So we're actually walking the mom through how to unpack her own history. She cannot give what she doesn't have. If she doesn't, first of all, know her value as a woman, as a mom, if Colby doesn't know his value as a man and a father, the baby will survive, the practical things will come. And what's been great is she has been able to see some truth. She continues to come in. She is still choosing to come in. Now, Colby has kind of taken a step back, so continue to pray for him. We believe that he has all the potential there. He has everything that he needs to be the dad that he's been called to be. So we want to continue to champion him. And then you saw in the video the nursery nook. There's a really small clip of those practical items that we can give moms and dads. So what they're doing is they're both building up points as they come in and they learn, and then they can kind of go shopping in the nursery nook and get those things that they need. So that's one big piece that we want to see continue to expand, is that nursery nook piece. The second focus is going to be on the next slide. Now, we have the Breaking Free program because we know that women need post-abortion care. It doesn't matter whether they're a Christian, a non-Christian, young, old. This is something that is going to be happening at a more rapid pace, particularly because they can take the abortion pill at home. So a lot of women not only have been living in secrecy since 1973, but we're going to see that spike even more, unfortunately. So we want to make sure that there are women know that there is a safe haven for them with the post-abortion care program we have. And then the sexual health and relationship, and then there's actually a Bible study course available for new Christians, leading someone to Christ. But the centerpiece is where I want to focus on with the sexual health and relationship. We are taking a look at revisiting the STD screening and treatment. That is kind of where we're seeing the greatest need in our community. That really is going to open up the window to not only serve men and women. So we're going to get to serve them on that sexual health piece, maybe before that crisis of that unplanned pregnancy happens. So we're establishing relationship with both men and women. And as we build the relationship, remember, he's the three in one, let us make man in our image. That is the goal. And the way that we see society kind of trailing right now, that's where we need to be. So for 5 years, again, the medical piece, we've been taking that journey. It's been a long haul, but God has been faithful. He has continued to sustain us, but there is one place in order for us to move forward in any of these areas, the parenting, the sexual health piece, and even the abstinence program going into the school districts. We do have a great staff. You can go to the next slide. We just hired Beth Robacker. We have two Beths and a Becca, and then Hillary. We have Beth Robacker. She's the client services director. We just hired her. She's also an RN. So while she's helping to get the Bright course and the parenting piece going, we're going to also continue to work together on the medical piece and the STD screening. Beth Euchert, she's our development coordinator. She's the one that did that video. So when I accidentally flip my computer screen upside down, she's the one that gets it right back up. I don't know how I did it. Too much clicking, I suppose. We have Rebecca Allison. She's not even working there yet, but she's going to be our new office manager. So this is where I'm saying God has kind of had us walking and walking and walking. A lot of staff changes over the past 5 years. Really no rhyme or reason to that, but I do believe that he is continuing to build our team. The one person that's still missing is our program coordinator that takes the education program into the schools. I am currently doing that right now. I think it would be best suited to actually have someone dedicated to that position. So if you know someone or you yourself might be interested, I will be here after the service if you want to talk to me about that. Let's see, did I have anything else? I think another focus, I want to kind of wrap up with this is, you know, you are a huge part of the mission and the vision of Next Step. We really can't continue forward without, I mean, first of all, the prayers. We need some breakthrough. We need some breakthrough on that medical piece. We need some breakthrough just on how we better reach our community. I mean, we've put out some billboards. Beth has done a great job with the marketing online. In fact, that's where we're seeing a great portion of our clients coming in is through the website. They're actually booking online. So that those efforts are working, and God has been faithful in that. But we do trust that God is going to bring us the breakthrough we need, and that is going to require some volunteers. So Beth Robacker, the client services director, she's put together a great volunteer training. So if you want to get involved on the client advocacy part, or even just kind of more behind the scenes with the nursery nook, she has got a couple great trainings set up for that. So again, if you are interested in that on any level, just to even ask some questions, we're available to answer those questions for you. And we're excited to see what God is going to do. We know that he's working, even though we can't always see it, we know he's working. So we are so grateful for your support, prayers, financial, even with Angie being a person that I can contact, that's a great place to have volunteers to be able to reach out and say, hey, I need this, I need that. Grace Community has been wonderful in supporting Next Step for so many years. So we just continue to ask for the prayer support as we move forward this year.
I'm going to keep Hillary up here for a minute, actually. Did she miss what I said? You thought you were. So one of the things we love doing at Grace is praying over people, so you're going to be one of the ones we pray over this morning. And just full disclosure, I know it's been tough. Methods have to change as times do, and you don't always know where times are going. We at Grace buy the mission. And if for the next 10 years we see one baby saved, we will gladly sign that check year in, year out. We support Next Step because of the mission, not because of all the other junk. It's a tough road to hoe, but we're glad you're doing it. So we're going to pray for Hillary. Anyone, do we have any birthdays? None? No? Yes? Yeah. And happy anniversary. There's Steve. Steve, how many years of wedded bliss has Tina endured? How many years? 26 years of what? Wedded bliss. Yes. So Congratulations to you. Is it your birthday? Well, get us, stay. Don't leave. All right, so it's Rocky's birthday. He's going to be 25. And how old will you be?
Nine.
You want to give a speech? No? Okay. You just did. Jeff, come on up. He's looking at me like, you know I can hit you, right? And then Kennedy, it's Kennedy's birthday coming up as well as Kim. So I thought I saw Kim. Is Kim around?
Is she here?
I thought I saw her, but maybe not. There she is. You want to have a birthday too? Okay. You just want to be with your brother? Okay, there you go. It's not his birthday. He just wants to be with his brother. So, there you go. That's what it's like being a big brother. You get nothing to yourself anymore. So, I know that because I'm the youngest. All right, come on up. We'd love to pray over these folks. We'll pray over Hillary for her ministry out there at Next Step and all the work they're doing, and then all the birthdays we have with Rocky and Jeff and Kennedy and Kim. Anyone we missed? Did we miss a birthday? And you're like, it was... No? Okay. Well, come on up. We'd love to pray over these folks this morning. How are you, buddy?
Good.
How have you been?
And on my birthday, his birthday.
You're right, right. Yes. So. She's up here somewhere. Here she goes. Yeah. All right, let's go ahead and step into a moment of prayer. Our Father, we are blessed, and we're blessed beyond measure. I wish that we could say that these things were that we've been given by you have been the work of our own hands, but they certainly are not. Lord, we thank you for Hillary and the work she's doing at Next Step. I pray that this year would be the best year they've ever had. Maybe not in numeric success, but Lord, give them momentum. Give them the ability to see around corners and know what the next trend is going to be and be on the front end of it. Your spirit knows where this world is headed. You are, we believe, in your omnipresence, you are currently in the future, just as you are currently with us now. And Father, I pray that you would give Hillary just a supernatural helping of your spirit to be able to know what's coming. We pray for Hillary the prophet this coming year, that she be able to know the future and step into it before it comes. We ask that we know the trend here is not necessarily abortive necessarily in our neighborhood, but there's many a parent who sees a new child as extra money, and I pray for them. I ask that you would give Hillary a voice into their lives. Use the online platforms to speak to them, to inspire legacy, as she talked about this morning. That we can see complete and total change come in the way that the way that people come at family. We know the cornerstone of our society is strong family. We pray that Hillary be a voice in that, and that Next Step and the Beths and the Rebeccas would be the people that could run that into the future. We lift up medical. We lift up the in-schools programs. Lord, give them fruit. And I pray that you would continue to encourage. Give Hillary a heart of steel, that she's able to take fiery darts, and she's able to hear criticism, and she's able to allow these things to push away without affecting her vision of what you desire her to do. Let her chase it hard. We love you, Jesus. We also pray for Rocky. We thank you for this young man that you've created, a man full of exuberance. Everyone else in this church reluctantly walks to the front. Rocky came to ensure that I knew that it was his birthday, and we thank you for that. Lord, we thank you for his joy for life, and we thank you for his love for you. And I pray that you would continue to build that into Rocky, that even at a young age, he can teach those around him what it looks like to be a follower of Jesus Christ, that he can be a good big brother, that his little brothers want to be around. And Lord, you can give him your Spirit who can speak into his little heart and who can quiet him when anger and worry and fear come, who can raise him up when courage needs to be underneath. And you can just give him the things that he needs, the strength that he needs. I pray for Jeff as well as he's leading his family. Oh, Lord, I want to ask for the best year Rocky's ever had this coming year. 2022, Rocky's best year. And for Jeff as well, same thing, best year he's ever had, that he can look back on this year and this moment and see that you began to do a work in his life that only you could do. And Lord, we thank you for Jeff, for him bringing his family, for the work that he does to support them and how he welcomes people into his home. We thank you for the way that he's parented his children, Adam and Becca and Abby and Matthew, and the way that he loves Wanda. We thank you for the example that we have in Jeff. And I also want to lift up Kennedy. Lord, what an amazing mind you have created in Kennedy, full of humor and fun and excitement. And she's just an awesome young lady that you've created in her, and we thank you for her. I pray that you would continue to give her health and safety and wellness and wisdom. Let her be a light and a shining example in her school and among her friend group, and give her peace and strength and wisdom in all that she does. I also want to lift up to you, Kim. Lord, what a blessing it is to me to be able to minister to someone who ministered to me as a child and raised me up and helped alongside of my parents to instill inside of me godly principles. And Lord, she still carries that out today. I pray that this next year, although sorrow's in the rearview mirror, Lord, I pray that blessing be in front of her, and that she be able to look forward at the future knowing that you have it well in hand, and that there is joy and peace on the other side. Lord, we thank you for all that you're doing. We thank you for the blessing that Kim is. We thank you for the blessing that Kennedy is. Best year they've ever had. Lord, we're praying it this morning, believing you're going to do it. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, our littles are free to head where they're going. Here's another. Well, if you got your Bible with you, Book of Matthew is where we're going to start, Matthew 28. Go ahead and get yourself over there. Matthew chapter 28 is where we'll be camping out today. So it seems to me, and I'm probably wrong, but this is how it seems, that one of the issues, and I say one of because we got plenty of issues facing our nation today, but one of the big ones is that we really don't have any common ground. That what we used to hold in common has been taken away. It used to be that it didn't matter what the philosophies of the person standing next to you were. If you were at a Steeler game together, you were brothers, right? You know what I'm saying? Like, that was the way that went. We had sports that was always that spot that we could agree, you know, that the Steelers are great, the Eagles are awful. You know, we could agree on those. Do we have Eagles fans here this morning? Anyone? Anyone? They wouldn't admit it. Yeah, because you get mugged after church. No, we would just pray for your salvation is all we would do. So, but it seems like all we have in common anymore is how much we hate each other. And it's an incredible place to be in our nation. Once upon a time, it was the Constitution, but even that's coming under fire. In the year 2019, Webster's Dictionary puts out the word of the year. It's like the most important word of the year. Do you know what the word of the year was in 2019? Post-truth. Do you know what that means? The word post-truth means that my feelings on something are more factual than objective fact. That how I feel about it is more true than objective fact. act. And that is where we are as a society. And you need to look no further than the last couple weeks to realize how true that is. And I believe that one of the reasons we are in the place we are is because we don't hold common ground anymore. What actually binds us together? What is our commonality? What holds us as a society together? And once upon a time, like I said, it was our Constitution. That was our common ground. That was what held us together. But and of course, our system of governance. There isn't a common ground there either. The framers of our Constitution, the people that, listen, by there has never been devised by man a greater system for human flourishing. There hasn't. God has designed some pretty good systems, but this is the best one man made, right? And the framers of our Constitution even said that our system of governance only works in a moral and religious people. It's the only way it'll work. And they're right, because the further we move from God, the more our system falls apart, because it only works in a moral people, and we don't have that common system of belief any longer. So we don't have people who are orienting their lives to fit around the person of Christ. We aren't forming our life around the person of Christ any longer, and we are watching as everything falls apart. And we started this topic, and we're ending it this week, this topic of discipleship. And that's why I spent the first 3 or 4 weeks talking through the subject of disciplines. Because if we are not forming our life around the person of Christ, and we're not disciplined to be like Jesus, then what will we have? Because we have a lot of churches in the nation today or in the world today who are very big on being loud, on having catchy music, on having nice facilities, and being very catchy in the way that they share the gospel. But the simple fact is, it's not the gospel. That what they are preaching is not the truth. They are preaching something different than what the Lord shared. And so much of discipleship is found in the idea of I'm sharing with you information. I'm going to share with you the teachings of Jesus Christ. It's passing on information. But if I could use that, if I could split that word information a little bit, he is trying to get us in formation behind the person of Jesus Christ. He's trying to form us to the image of Jesus Christ. So as we seek to land this plane this week on the idea of discipleship, I want to take us to this passage in the book of Matthew. So Matthew chapter 28, starting off in verse 18. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go." Listen, that's all he needed to say. Go. He was kind and shared what he wanted us to do when we went, right? But go is the command. Therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And catch this, verse 20. Teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I'm with you always, to the end of the age. So, one of the things that I kind of came to as I was studying for this was, what did Jesus actually command us? What are the commands of Christ? And so you should have, everyone have one of those? You have the sheet of paper that has the commands of Christ? Buckle up for a few hours, we're going through all 50. Right? No, we're just going to do like 3 of them. But I wanted you to have that. This is a breakdown of the commands of Christ. If you don't have one, we have a bunch of them up front. Amy will give them out. Lana doesn't have one. Give her 2. Amy will make her way around. So while she's doing that, I'm going to have Lisa play a couple songs for you just to pull in a little bit this idea of commonality. So Lisa, why don't you go ahead and play that first one?
Okay.
All right, so stop that one. That doesn't do anything for you? You didn't want to stand together for America's hat? Right? Canada, it's just America's hat. It's not a real country. Right? We love you, Canada, but get it together. Right? How about this one? What do you do when you hear this? Go ahead. I don't know what that is. Okay. What do you do? Hi, Lisa, that's good. Thank you. All right, go ahead and have a seat. But we know what you're to do. Like, what was funny was our kids didn't. Just put that out there. Like, so a bunch of kids are like, why is everyone standing up? You know? But everyone that's in the military was like, I'd better stand up, right? If you had a hat on, what would you have done? You took it off, right? And I saw you put your hands over your heart. Like, this is what we do because we all have this in common, right? We are citizens. Like, oh, Canada didn't do a whole lot for you. Sorry, I wish it did. I mean, you know, it's a nice song. But this one means something to us. We've got this in common. And everyone, didn't matter what they were doing, stood and put their hand over their heart. I decided not to because, as it turns out, Marines are rather shy. They prefer to, you know, kill you from distance. I guess. I don't know. But I was going to have several, we have like 5 guys in the church that are Marines. And I was going to have them come up and get into formation for you. And they still can. They were like, oh yeah, I know how to do that. I can do it in my sleep. You could rouse me from a dead sleep, which the Marines did, and make you get into formation. They know how to do that. And I was going to have them do that for you. You know, how these men who are very, so the men are Rob, Josh, Sean, Steve, Hovis, and Art. Any other Marines other than them? Did I miss any? No? Okay. So, and we have some fellas that are Navy guys. So Keith there, Navy man. So, but when you say fall into a Marine, that means something. It means something different to a Navy guy, I'd assume. Fall in means something different in the Navy. And he's like, no, that's the Coast Guard. They're Navy man never falls in. That's the Coast Guard. You know. So anyway, maybe it means something different. I don't know. But they are different men, different walks of life, different family structures, different looks, different. You know, they're completely different men. But when they're called to fall in, they know what that looks like, and they can. So Steve, what was the phraseology again? Fall in. Stand by.
Attention.
Attention.
Dress right, dress.
And then you'd be formed. Yeah. So, like, that was the commands. Is that what was the Navy? How'd they work through that? Shots fired, everyone. There's shots fired. yeah. But for those on the internet who mean our church harm, we have 5 Marines and men from the Navy here. So come out here acting stupid. You're gonna find out, and that's how it works at this church. You're not getting out alive if you come in here meaning harm. So, and real jobs to do. Oh boy. Boy, and the church has split now. Now we know. Yeah, that's right. I'll show myself out. It's yeah, I know him. Yeah. Yeah. All right. But they're all different men. But like one of the things that Amy and I got flown down a few years ago down to Paris Island to see how Marines were made. And one of the things they shared with us was that their goal throughout basic is, in the first couple weeks, it's actually called forming. That they're forming you into something different. And that's the idea. We are going to dismantle you as a human being and rebuild you how we want you to be. And they're good at it. And they can tear you down. This is all branches of the military, but they can tear you down real fast and rebuild you within 8 weeks. So it was real cool. We got to see the new recruits coming in, the kid couldn't even wear his hat correctly, which I didn't know there was wrong ways to wear your hat, but there are. And he had it on wrong, and he's like walking around, and everything's falling apart, and like he just looked like a mess. And 8 weeks later, you think that same, that kid that looked like that 8 weeks ago, you see him graduate, completely different human. Right? We didn't stay the whole 8 weeks, but you know, you can compare, right? And what was neat was we were kind of listening as parents would say things like, now where's our, like they couldn't find their own child because they looked so similar when they were all together, you know, and they're like trying to figure out which kid was theirs. Wasn't that, you know, it was just crazy how much they could form everyone into looking the same. And the idea here isn't that we will all be identical. It's that we all, when we are called to fall in behind Jesus Christ, we know what that looks like. And we are being obedient to the commands of Christ. And that when we form up behind him, that we look just like Jesus. That's the goal. So that's our military thing, I guess, you know. There you go. But the point is that the most elite fighting force on the planet, the United States military, forms up everyone. They have that commonality. They start with a foundation. And I bring that up because the idea of discipleship is to bring people into formation behind Jesus Christ. That we are to form up behind Jesus, to look the way that he looks. And what I want to help you see is in the world we inhabit today, that there's it's very New Age thinking that and we talked about that at the front end with the idea of post-truth, that I have my truth and you have your truth and then there's the truth and all of them are equally valid, and they are not. There is one truth and I can either get behind it or I don't. But there's only one truth. And just because I don't like the truth doesn't make it not true. Like the truth doesn't really care how I feel about it. It's true whether I like it or not. And much of Scripture has fallen into the category of, I don't like that. And much of God's truth has fallen in the category of, I don't care for that, therefore I reject it. And listen, God's truth stands whether you like it or not. And therefore, we start to replace things with our own truth because we like our own truth better. And when we start to disciple people, we disciple them in our truth instead of discipling him in the truth of Jesus Christ. And so that's why I bring up Matthew 28. I'll read through that again. And Jesus came and said to them, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, teach them to observe or obey. Anyone's Bible say obey? Yeah? No? All that I've commanded you. And behold, I'm with you always to the end of the age. And you can sit back and you say, that's restrictive. And you're right. But the truth will set you free. Because you can look and say, like, I don't like budgets because it's restrictive. And you'd be right. But it sets you free. You can say eating the right things and rejecting things that I shouldn't be eating is restrictive, and you would be right, but it sets you free. That the more I restrict my life around the truth of the commands of Jesus Christ, the more free I'll become, even though I'm restricting my life. I don't know much about horses, and by that I mean I know more than I would like to know, because I don't like horses. And so everyone I've been on has tried to buck me off, every single one. And I'm just like, I know it's me. I know I'm the problem. I don't care to fix it. So, like, you know, if it doesn't have a motor and brakes, no interest. Have you ever, like, seen a horse, like a wild horse running, and then you have a rider with a saddle and a bridle, and he can, although that horse is carrying couple 300 extra pounds, it can run down one that's not carrying anything? You ever wondered how that happens? Because to get maximum performance out of the animal, you got to put restriction on it. Does that make sense? Like, no, it doesn't. It doesn't make any sense. But a horse is faster with a rider with a bridle because he can get performance out of it that a wild one can't get. And he can chase down that. So when we think about, oh, I can't, that's too restrictive for me, stop and realize that when you live a life with no boundaries, you are actually less free than the one who puts tight boundaries around their life. So as we teach the commands of Christ, we must be in our own lives seeking to be obedient to the commands of Christ. Because if we are not being obedient, how can I teach that to somebody else? And that's why we started the idea of discipleship with being disciplined, being in prayer, being in fellowship, being in the Word of God. Because if I'm not disciplined to be about the Father's work, then how can I teach that to somebody else? And what I've tried to pull the curtain back on a little bit is that it is easier to obey the commands of man than it is to obey the commands of Christ. That it's easier to make up my own rules and try and follow my own rules than it is to obey the commands that Jesus has given me. And I can discipline people to be more like me, but it's harder to discipline them to be like Jesus. That's difficult. It's hard work. But it sets you free. And if I'm going to bring someone else into formation with Christ, I need to be formed in the image of Christ as well. And most of what discipleship is just that. It's sharing information. Here are the commands of Jesus that we are to follow. And then holding each other accountable to those things. And what I might be hearing you say is, I say, like, we are all to be discipling somebody, is I don't know how to disciple someone. Like, is that what you're feeling? Like, I don't know how to disciple people. Don't know how that's done. Well, the challenge, or what I would kind of put against you, or push back on that a little bit with this, then you don't know how to follow Christ yourself either. Because it's just teaching people how to obey the commands of Jesus Christ. How do you do it? Right? How do you find it's easier to follow the commands of Christ? That's Isaac and I've met for years, and that's one of the things he talks about. Hey, when you encounter this, how do you do this? Well, here's how I found that works for me. You know, and we talk through those things. I'm just teaching you how I find following the commands of Christ, but I'm still teaching you to follow the commands of Christ. It's just the way that works for me. And that accountability creates in us an urgency to follow, because he knows I'm going to call him and ask him about it. You know, if he shares something with me, like, hey, I'm trying to follow after this command of Christ, can you help me? Yeah, absolutely. Tomorrow, I'm giving you a call. Hey, how'd it go? That accountability breeds an urgency in our hearts. So let's look at a few commands of Christ. We're just going to walk through a couple of Jesus' commands and see what he had to say. There's 50 of them, like I said. We print them out for you. But we're going to talk through a couple of them. And what I want you to see as you kind of look over that list is that nowhere in the list did Jesus talk about how you dress. Like, he wasn't that concerned about what you eat, what you drink. He wasn't that he didn't get all wound up about the color of the carpet in your church, or the style of the chair, like, or the type of music. He wasn't all that concerned about it, but he did talk quite a bit about repentance, about love, about forgiveness, and about grace. So the teachings of Christ were centered around things that truly mattered. And when he gives a command, you see I hope you sit down and over the next week or so, read through those scriptures. Take a couple a day and read through those scriptures. Or if you're feeling crazy, take one a week, and it'll take you about a year, and go through and just take one a week and reread those scriptures and go through them slowly and familiarize yourself with what Jesus actually commanded us, so that you're able to look at what really mattered to him. And what you'll see as you work through those scriptures is that Jesus came with this deep concern for your heart and your soul, because he knew that if you weren't obedient to his commands, that your destination is hell. And so his desire was not to see you burn. So Jesus doesn't really come wagging his finger in self-righteousness telling you how to live. Jesus came in love and care and concern as one who loves you deeply and doesn't want your soul to be destroyed, begging you to repent, knowing it's your only hope. I've been reading through the biography on Dietrich Bonhoeffer. Anyone know who Dietrich Bonhoeffer is? Heard that name before? He was a a pastor and theologian, martyr and spy, which is just cool. Listen, if your pastor gets involved in an assassination plot on Hitler, he's a real good pastor, right? But Dietrich was a pastor in Germany in the 1930s, and he made the statement that grace is actually protected by repentance, that unless you go through repentance, you will never make it to grace, and you will never reach the gospel of Jesus Christ unless you go first through repentance, and that repentance is key to being a follower of Jesus. And so you'll see these things that Jesus talked about, not in self-righteous judgment, but in care and concern for your soul. So Matthew 16 is where the first command I want to look at. Matthew chapter 16, verse 5, should be a black hardbacked Bible in the seat in front of you. You're welcome to keep that. If you don't own a Bible, the page number is actually on the screen if you want to have a shortcut to turning to it. But if you don't own a Bible, we want you to own a Bible. It's important to us. So we welcome you to take that. We've got plenty of them. They make more every day, and you're welcome to have that one. All right, looking at verse 5. When the disciples reached the other side, they'd forgotten to bring any bread. Seems to be a common theme among the disciples. And Jesus said to them, "Watch and beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and Sadducees," which is a weird statement considering I said, "I don't have any bread," and he said, "Well, don't eat theirs." Okay, you know. And they began discussing it amongst themselves, saying, "Well, we brought no bread." But Jesus, aware of this, said, "Oh, you of little faith," which I imagine he said this, "Oh, you of little faith." I feel like he said that a lot. "Why are you discussing amongst yourselves the fact that you have no bread? Do you not yet perceive? Do you not remember the 5 loaves for the 5,000 and how many baskets you gathered? Or the 7 loaves for the 4,000 and how many baskets you gathered? How is it that you fail to understand that I did not speak about bread? Beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and Sadducees." And then they understood that he did not tell them to beware of the leaven of bread, but the teaching of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. So what's Jesus saying here? Leaven, bread, we don't have bread, like we need bread. No, Jesus flat out said, "Listen, you need bread, I'll give you some. And I don't even need it to give it to you." Right? If you want bread, I got bread. The fact is, watch out for the teaching of the Pharisees, because they were teaching performance-based religion. And that is alive and well in the church today. You know, the performance-based religion. If you do these things, then God will do these things, right? Now, we see it today in something called the prosperity gospel. It's not new. It's old. It's if you have enough faith and you do the right things and you pray the right prayers and you go to the right church and you give the right amount of money, God will bless you with the things that you're supposed to have, including a big house and a Mercedes. Right? That's performance-based religion. I've got to do. Because what we hear on the other side is, if I'm ill, then it's because of a lack of faith. And that's not true. It's not a lack of faith that causes illness. Sin caused illness. And it's not your sin that caused illness, just sin, right? So people say, like, "He has cancer, so I wonder what sin they've committed that caused..." No, that's not how that works. It's not your sin that causes illness, it's just sin. And that's self-righteous religiosity. Listen, people chasing hell from the pew of a church. And that's the fast track to hell because you don't even know you're going. But what Jesus called us to do is deny a performance-based religion and truly have a relationship with him. Deny a performance-based religion and chase after him. And whether it be prosperity gospel or leaven of the Pharisees, it's the same thing. Performance-based religion, if you just check these boxes off. And you'll hear, you know, people say, like, you know, they're sick, so they must have sin. So let's get the, right? A dangerous trend in churches that are more charismatic is something called a demon trial. Have you heard of this? You heard of this? Raise your hand if you heard of a demon trial. That there is a stronghold of Satan in your life, and we need to put the demons on trial. Show me that in here, you cannot. We need to put the demons on trial so that we can get the stronghold out of your life so that God can bless you. Right? Nowhere in Scripture. So what these churches will do is actually give you a form and have you fill out every sin you've ever committed, name every person you've ever had sexual relations with. I mean, like, evil stuff. So that, listen, that's a power grab. Don't play. Because at that point, I've got it in writing authority over your life. Isn't it? And that's nothing but evils from the bowels of hell, and you need to curse that. But it's that self-righteous religiosity. And you'll see them like, ask the demon what its name is. There's one person ever in history that was ever had success with that. You know who that person was? Jesus. You know why he asked him the name? Because he knew them. In fact, he's the creator of all things. He created them. He knows who they are. We believe deeply that there is a spiritual warfare going on in the world today. We believe deeply there are strongholds in your life. It is not a call upon my life to put a demon on trial. He will eat my lunch 8 days a week. I'll be the eighth son of Shiva, right? Wasn't that the seven sons of Shiva who went in and tried to cast a demon out? And they said, in the name of Jesus, who Paul preaches, come out of the man. And the demon responded, which is always a bad sign. And he responds, Jesus, I know. Paul, I've heard of. Who are you? And then he beat them till they were naked and they ran away. Listen, I don't know how much you know about fighting, but if you run away naked, you lost, right? Like, you had pants on when you started, and you at the end of the fight, you don't. You did not come out victorious. You might have got a few good hits in, but you didn't win, right? You are not called to wrangle with the demons. You are called to be obedient to the person of Jesus Christ. He will cast out. He will do that work. It's not on you. And so we hear people say you have cancer because of a lack of faith or because of your sin. You don't. It's because sin is in the world, not because of yours. You have a wayward child. Well, that's your sin. Let's dig in. No, you have a wayward child because of sin, not yours. And this performance-based religion is nothing but another method by which Satan can use to accuse you. And that's his name, isn't it? The accuser of the brethren? This is just how he does it. Oh, you're failing. You're failing too much. There's no grace in performance-based religion. There's no room for failure. Listen, look at us. We're a people that need room for failure, aren't we? But there is room in repentance and relationship with Jesus Christ for you to fail, and for you to fail often, and for you to fail big, and for him to pick you back up, lovingly dust you off, and continue on the road of life with you. There is room to fail with Jesus, and there is none in performance-based religion. Because here's the danger of performance-based religion. Let's say you live a perfect life, and then you sin, and then you die, you're done. Going to hell because you failed and you didn't perform. Satan is a liar. And if you're going to speak that truth. He's a liar and he knows where his end is. And that's all we need to say to him. Matthew chapter 7 will be the next chunk we're going to look at. So go left a little bit. As soon as you see it, you'll be like, I know this one. Matthew 7, starting in verse 12. If you want your baby pinched, Sandy will do it for you. I'll tell you this. We say it often. I'm going to say it all the time because it's true. The noise that children make in church is very quiet compared to the sound of no children. And we cherish our children here. In fact, like you saw, like when kids left, half the church was emptied out. And it's a good problem to have. And we will rejoice in that. Even if we're running out of seats, like, we'll just pull kids up on laps. That makes an empty seat, and there you go. We believe deeply that kids matter. We see them tearing up stuff. Like, I think there's a spot downstairs where someone drew on a wall with Sharpie. That's life. But we can repaint. The cost on a child's life of not being about the things of God is much more expensive than paint. All right, that's not in my notes. That was free. All right, so verse 12. So whatever you wish that others would do to you, do also to them. For this is the law and the prophets. Enter by the narrow gate. For the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction. And those who enter by it, there are many. For the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life. And those who find it are few. That's the golden rule, right? Do unto others as you'd have them do to you. Now, we live by a different golden rule that's like, I'm going to do to others before they do to me, right? And that seems to be the golden rule of the world that we inhabit. Do unto others before they do to me. But that's not the command. The command is the way I want to be treated, I should treat other people. I want people to be generous, so I have to be generous, right? I need to do the things that I'm expecting others to do. I want people to tell me when I'm wrong. I don't like it, but I want them to. Like, hey, here's why you're off base on this. And I want them to tell me why I'm not correct. Now, listen, if you come to me and tell me why I'm not correct, I'm really sure about why I'm correct, so expect an argument. But if you can argue me into a corner, there's a good chance I'm going to listen, right? I want people to let me know when I'm wrong. You can do that with tact. Listen, if you come at me and you say, listen, let me tell you why you're wrong, get ready for a fight, right? But if you come and say, have you thought about it this way? I'm going to be much easier to get along with. Isn't that, like, you can do that with that. Isn't there a way people can approach you and you're like, oh, is this how this is going to go? Okay. Isn't it? If someone comes at you that way? The way we approach people matters. I tell people if they got something stuck in their teeth, I want to know. So I'll let you know, right? I don't typically comment on if someone's hair's messy. I just don't feel like that's my space. But maybe it should be, because mine's never out of place. It's always straight, always the same length, right? Except for when my beard gets real long. Then things get crazy, and Amy's like, you should cut that. There's food in it. So once I was working in Virginia, before I got married, I just let things go because no one cared. I had this big beard at one point, and zip it in my coat every now and then, big beard, you know. And my boss was like, I need a pen. And I was like, oh, here's one. I pulled it out of my beard. And he's like, I'm not touching that. That's gross, you know. I also had really long hair, and I have a video of that if you want to see it, like to my shoulders, long hair. All right. But what I want people to do for me, I try and do for them. Because that's the rule, right? That's the command. Do to others as you would have them do to you. We have fallen victim, however, to a very deceptive and a very dangerous thing, offense. How often have you heard that? If I could eliminate one word from the human language right now, it would be, I'm offended. That's two words. Or is it three? I'm's like a conjunction. I don't know the rules. Help me. It's two. Okay, two words. I'm offended. I'd take that out. People who are offended become belligerent and angry, and they frighten the majority of people into compliance. Or at least into silence. I saw a video of a couple ladies that were so angry with a man for not wearing a face mask that they felt justified in physically assaulting him. And then they realized the optics of that weren't very good because it was two white ladies beating up a black man. So they began, as they were beating him, to scream, "Black Lives Matter." Because since he offended me by not wearing a mask, I was justified in physically assaulting him. And then, given the race dynamics, to make up for the fact that I was assaulting a person of minority descent, I needed to yell "Black Lives Matter." Made it okay. Right? I had a roommate in college that worked at a mental health home, and sometimes you have to restrain people that have mental health issues. And he had to say, "Pardon my touch," before he body slammed a person, right? So he would grip, he'd say, "Pardon my touch," and then slam him into the ground. But he had to say it, right? And just saying it made it okay. I'm sure the guy that got slammed to the ground didn't really care either direction. I just would rather not be thrown down. I don't care what you said on the front end of it. I'm sure he's not laying there like, "Well, thank you for pardoning that. Yeah, that made it all right." It doesn't make it okay, right? You know, and here's the danger of offense. It creates in you self-righteousness. I've never heard a person who is angry say, "I'm completely wrong, but," right? Everyone who gets very angry is convinced that they're right. And it creates in us a self-righteousness. But we need to desire for people to tell us when we're wrong. And if I could, just on the subject of being offended, they aren't offended. And they aren't angry. Offense and anger are tools by which I can force you to do what I want. I'm just using a tool. I'm not actually angry. I'm not actually offended. It's a tool to force silence and compliance. So my argument would be, don't comply. Stand on what's right. Speak the truth. If I'm going to speak the truth, I will bother someone with it. And if they're offended, they are just using a tool to try and get me to shut up. And if they're offended, that means I should talk louder. Last one, Book of Luke. Do to others what you'd have them do to you. I want to know what the truth is. Speak the truth. All right, Luke chapter 24, verse 49. "And behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you. But stay in the city until you are clothed with power from on high." Now, we have this habit of turning holy things into catchy slogans. Have you caught this? Like we see this a lot in very, very popular churches where they will make a catchy slogan to try and stick it in your brain, the truth of God's word. You know what I'm talking about? I don't think that's a good thing. I think the truth of God's word is too complex for a bumper sticker. I think the truth of God's word should not be reduced to the three C's of following Christ or whatever, you know, the catchy thing is that we're trying to do. That we should talk deep and we should talk long and we should investigate hard the truth of God's word. And when we make it a catchy little slogan, we're robbing it of power. Because there's a lot of might and a lot of power and a lot of strength in waiting for God to speak. You know, in the book of Psalms chapter 46, David is told to be still and know that I'm God. And Moses is told in Exodus 14:14, "I'll fight for you. You have only to be still." And then the disciples here were told to wait, focus on the Lord, power is coming. And when we wait for God to speak and we wait for God to move, we can see him do his work in the waiting. And we don't falter on the promise, God does not falter on his promises. So Isaiah chapter 40, I'm going to read this for you real quick. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 29. He gives power to the faint. And to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even you shall faint and be weary. Even young men shall fall exhausted. But they who, what? Wait for the Lord will renew their strength. And they shall mount up with wings like eagles. And they shall run and not be weary. And they will walk and not faint. So the disciples had to learn how to wait for the Lord. And I think we as disciples need to learn how to wait on the Lord. And wait for him to move. And wait for him to speak. The church is not short on self-help and on advice and on strategies. The church isn't short on that, right? I'm sure Hillary steps foot in a lot of churches and every single one of them thinks they should be doing something different, right? The church isn't short on strategies. The church is short on waiting for God to move and waiting for God to deliver power to do the things he desires us to do. We talked about this just this last week in our council. There's some stuff in our community that needs handled. We're seeking how to build into the Sligo pool. It's in our backyard. It could use some help, both financially, but more than that, it needs a culture change. And what we talked about at our meeting was this: we have time. We'll wait. We will let God speak. We'll let God move. We'll let him show us where he wants us to go. We see the problem. We're going to pray and wait. And there's power in being still and power in waiting and letting God do what only he can do. Because I promise you this, he doesn't need you to do the work he's going to do. Wait on him. Let him move. And let God do what only he can do. And he will show up in power that you never thought imaginable. Because we are woefully deficient as disciples of Christ. And a lot of that isn't because we don't have strategies. And it's not even because we're not willing to work. The reason that we are woefully deficient as disciples is because we are not willing to wait on the power of God. We're short on power. So when we talk about being formed up behind Jesus Christ, we need to know his commands, know what he's called us to do, and form our lives around that. Before the power of the Spirit comes, we need the form of discipline around our lives. If we're going to see the Spirit come in power and fire, we're going to pray and close out and bring up our musical folk. Would you stand with me as we close out? Our Father, we are blessed and we are thankful and we are constantly amazed at the power that you can come and bring and do and work in our community. We thank you, Jesus, for all you do here at this little church. We praise you for being who you are, for being gracious and kind, loving, forgiving, for offering to us the opportunity to repent that we may turn from our sin and follow after you. Jesus, would you come and form us as your disciples, teaching us to obey all your commands. And Lord, may we then teach that to others. We love you, Christ. Thank you for all you do for us. In your name we pray. Amen.
You called me from the grave by name. You called me out of all my shame. I see the old is passed away. the new has come. Now I have resurrection power living on the inside, Jesus. You have given us freedom. No longer bound by sin and darkness, living in the light of your goodness. You have given us freedom. I'm dressed in your royalty. Your Holy Spirit lives in me. I see my past has been redeemed. The new has come. Now I have resurrection power. I'm no longer bound by sin and darkness, living in the light of your goodness. You have given us freedom. Now I have resurrection power, living on the inside, Jesus. You have given us freedom. And I'm no longer bound by sin and darkness.
In the grove.
All right. Well, songs aren't just something we sing. It's something we corporately agree on these things, you know, and it's important that we sing together. We are blessed by God with victory over sin now. You know, that you, it's not someday. I know you read through Revelation and you see that at the word of Christ, he destroys the armies of Satan and the work that he has done, and that one day that victory is coming, but today you can have victory over sin in your life found in the blood of Jesus Christ. So one thing we like doing here at Grace is the doxology. We sing that together week in, week out. The reason we do it is because it's good for our hearts to be reminded that every blessing we have truly does come from Jesus Christ. So Susan, would you lead us in that? Lord Jesus, our Savior, we are blessed beyond any blessing just to be able to speak your name. I thank you for saving us. I thank you for coming and dying for our sins. I thank you for the way that you graciously lead us into what's good and right and true. And Lord, that I pray that we would take these commands that you've given us and truly begin to see them, not as suggestions, not as good advice, not as nice sayings that are needle-pointed on a pillow somewhere in my grandma's house, but as true commands that you desire that we obey. And may we be a people who seek to obey. And Lord, when we fail, we thank you for your forgiveness. In your name we pray. Amen. Have a seat real quick. Got a couple of things just by way of announcement. Take a moment, if you are able, and shake Hillary's hand. Give her a big hug. Thank her for the work that she and her family are doing out at Next Step. It is an awesome work. The other thing is, we have some proposed amendments to our bylaws. It's just bylaws, not a perfect document. We wrote it ourselves, so it's really not perfect. And couple of different locations, tables in the front and in the back. There should be a copy of this for you to be able to look over, pray over, bring any questions you have about that. So please do that. Ladies Guild's meeting on the 7th this Tuesday, or 7th, at 7 p.m. this Tuesday. So if you're a lady, please go to that. You will not be disappointed. You'll love it. We have a church breakfast next Sunday, 8 a.m. And then next Sunday also at 3 p.m., our students, our high schoolers are going tubing. So up at Mount Pleasant, not in Pittsburgh, but Edinburgh. So there's more than one. And that's when we're going there. We'll have Sunday school, we'll have some lunch here, and then we'll head out. So be here for that. We still have a couple spots available, I think, Angie, right? So we still have a handful of spots available if you would like to go. February 20th, the baby bottles are due back. Hillary won't be here to collect them, but we'll take them to her, and she'll be taking those. We'll be voting on the bylaws on the 27th, so please stick around for that, but we'll get more into these things as the date draws near. All right, that's it. Head on downstairs. Go ahead and get your stuff together. Did she get the box? Where's the box? Okay, so let me talk about that for a moment. I won't make you do it, honey. She's like relieved, like, oh my gosh. As a service project that Cass is doing, there's a box out there for you to donate stuff like what? And where's it going? Okay, so Blessings Foster Care Ministry is getting a donation. It's a service project that Cassie's putting on, and it's a hygiene products, gently used clothing, stuff like that, right? Used is okay? Yeah. So she has a box out there in the foyer for you to put that stuff in. So please plan on getting some things and putting them in there so she can donate to the to that ministry down in foster care. So, all right, coffee, cookies, fruit, snacks, all kinds of stuff downstairs. So please head down there, do some fellowship. Even if you're planning to leave after church, please at least do that. Talk to some people. Have a great Sunday. We love you. See you soon.